Hello friends, this video on Reproductive Health Part 15 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Next question, what are the suggested reasons for population explosion? Now, why the population is like continuously increasing so much? So, two major reasons are increased birth rate, too many children are being born. Decreased death rate. The death rate has decreased. Now there are various things which has caused the decrease in death rate. For example, improved medical facilities. So the medical science has shown a lot of improvements and many diseases have got cure, and that is why the death rate has reduced. Again, awareness about this for diseases, like now people know, okay, if I get this symptom, so it might be this, so they immediately take preventive measures. Child immunization has been put into place. Now all the children are given immunization in the right time, and that is why the infant mortality rate has also reduced. So these are some of the factors which has decreased the death rate. Now similarly, the birth rate is increasing again, because there are still many people who give birth to a lot of children just for the sake of a male child. Sometimes people go for uncasual, unprotected sex, which lead to the birth, which again give rise to more and more children, even though they don't want it. So these are basically the two reasons for the population explosion. Question number 6, is the use of contraceptives justified? Give reasons. Yes, it is. That is what we spoke about in the last question. We don't want population explosion, so we want to control the population. So how can the population be controlled? Now, we just cannot kill people to increase the death rate, right? That cannot be done. So what we can do is, we can reduce the birth rate. And how can we reduce the birth rate? It is fine to have smaller families. Having one kid or two kids is fair enough. We really don't need 7-8 kids. So that is how we can control population explosion, and contraceptives help us to do that. So therefore, it is completely justified to avoid unwanted pregnancy and to control the population growth. Question number 7. Amniocentesis for sex determination is banned in our country. Is that ban necessary? Comment. Now, what is amniocentesis? Let us first understand this term. Now, amniocentesis is a prenatal diagnostic technique which can determine the sex of the fetus. Now, when the female is just pregnant, so inside the fetus is formed. Now, there is a technique, like how you have various diagnostic techniques like ultrasound, MRI, etc. Similarly, this is a diagnostic technique where the sex of the fetus can be determined looking at its genetic arrangement. Now, what happens is, these days the ban is extremely necessary, because these days people misuse it. How they get to know the sex of their baby, and then accordingly, what do? If it is a girl child, they get a female feticide done. So they just get it aborted because they say that they don't want a girl child. So that is a misuse of it, and that is why it has been banned, and this ban is extremely necessary. So that is one thing. Now, you might ask, then why was this technique brought into place? Now, this technique was brought into place because it served two purposes. One was, it could determine the sex of the fetus. The next thing was, it could diagnose genetic disorders, if any, in the fetus. Now, if the genetic disorders could be diagnosed at such an early stage, maybe some improvements or some amendments could have been done on it, so that you do not end up having a genetically disordered baby. So that is why it was started, but then people started misusing it in the wrong way. So amniocentesis is banned due to its misuse, followed by female feticide. Now, it is not banned in all the countries. In many countries, people really do not distinguish much between male and female child. So there, this problem of female feticide does not exist. But in our country, in India, this is strongly banned, because female feticide is quite common. However, it has reduced to some extent these days, but still it happens. Question number 8. What are the measures one has to take to prevent from contracting STDs? Now, as I said, prevention is always better than cure. So some of the precautions which you can take so that STDs can be prevented are use of condoms, wash before and after the intercourse, confirm that the partner is HIV tested before intercourse, avoid multiple partners because that is extremely dangerous, Complete treatment post-diagnosis of STD. So now once you're infected, you should not feel ashamed of it, because now something which has happened has already happened. There is no point thinking about it. So better to get it treated, get it cured, and be happy. Question number 9. State true or false with explanation. Abortions could happen spontaneously too. Yes, of course it can happen spontaneously. It is not necessary that you always need to plan it. Infertility is defined as the inability to produce a viable offspring and is always due to abnormalities or defects in the female partner. Of course not. The abnormality can be in the female partner or it can be in the male partner as well. So this statement is false, because we saw that sometimes the male partner do not have good quality sperms, or they do not have a good sperm count. And sometimes there can be problem with the female also, for example, a blocked fallopian tube, or some issues with the uterus. So both ways the problems can be there. Complete lactation could help as a natural method of contraception. Well, lactation would help. I agree on that part, but it is not a natural method of contraception forever. Of course, it is a natural method for some time, but it will be applicable only up to 6 months. So beyond that, it doesn't serve as a method of contraception. So this statement is not completely true. So we will mark it as false. Creating awareness among sex-related aspects is an effective method to improve reproductive health of the people. Of course, and that is what we have been doing while studying this lesson. So reproductive health is all about creating awareness among people with anything related to sex or reproduction or infertility. So anything related to that. So we just want to create awareness among people. Question number 10 and the last question of this lesson. Correct the following statements. Surgical methods of contraception prevent gamete formation. Well, this is not right, because surgical methods, what they do is gamete formation still happens. Because for example, what happens in surgical method? If you talk about vasectomy, the vas deferens is broken, the tube is broken and tied up in between. So the gametes are still formed, because gametes are being formed in the testes, but the gametes transfer cannot happen. Similarly, in case of females, the fallopian tube is broken. So the gamete formation, that is egg formation, happens from the ovary. So that is still taking place, but the gamete transfer is not happening. So the gamete formation should be replaced with transfer, or gamete transfer, or gamete flow, whatever you call it. So the gamete movement basically is not happening. All sexually transmitted diseases are completely curable. Well, we would not say that all of them are curable. So all is not the right word. Most of them are curable, and that too if they are detected at an early stage. So detection at an early stage is also very, very important. And not all of them are curable, because we have an example of an incurable disease, and that is AIDS, so which is still an incurable. Oral pills are very popular in contraceptives among the rural women. Well, oral pills, they are very easy to take, not much of complication. Side effects are also less. They are popular contraceptives, that is fine, but not among the rural women, but it is more common among the urban women, because they find it more convenient to use and all. They do not want to go for surgery or things like that. So it is more common in urban women. In ET techniques, what is ET techniques? Embryo transfer techniques. Embryos are always transferred into the uterus. Not necessarily, because we spoke about scenarios, right? There are two ways. One is ZIFT, that is zygote intrafallopian transfer. So in that case, if you are transferring a very early embryo, like when it is maybe 8 cell, not even 8 cell stage, less than 8 cell stage. So that time it is not transferred to the uterus. That time it is transferred to the fallopian. That time it is transferred to the fallopian tube. So it can be transferred to the uterus or the fallopian tube. Now when it is transferred to the uterus, that time, if you are transferring a developed embryo, maybe which is more than 8 cell stage, that time you should transfer it to the uterus. But if you are trying to transfer an early embryo which has less than 8 cell, which is less than 8 cell, in that case you have to transfer it to the fallopian tube, because that is how the process of reproduction happens, right? The fusion happens in the ampullar region of the fallopian tube, and then zygote is formed. The zygote gradually forms an early embryo and it remains in the fallopian tube. It reaches the uterus only when it forms the early blastocyst, which is more than 8 cell structure. So only when it reaches that stage, you will transfer it to the uterus. Otherwise, it can be transferred to the fallopian tube also. So it is not necessary that embryo transfer always has to happen to the uterus. So I think with this, we have reached towards the end of this lesson, and I hope that this lesson on reproductive health would have helped you. So these are some of the very common things which all of you should know. This lesson was not much on concepts, but it was more about creating awareness among people like you. So I hope this lesson would have helped you. So see you all in the next lesson. Thank you. Please visit www.examfear.com to watch more videos, attempt free online test, get free study material, find tutors and mentors. Thank you once again.